Hi guys, I want to bring you up to speed when it comes to my research on the atmosphere surrounding atoms. A few months ago I discovered that our universe is much more organized than I envisioned. When I thought of a cloud of, say, hydrogen atoms, a cloud of gas, I always envisioned those molecules or atoms flying or around, and I envisioned the gravitons also flying around, crisscross, not very organized. But I've learned along the way that indeed there is much more systematic, much more, what's the proper word in English? Well, I can't find it, but it's more organized than I thought. That's what I found. I don't want to break up speed, right? At first I wanted to bring it home. I was calculating, and allow me to show you. You see here these maps. I've been calculating everything about the hydrogen spectra, about the hydrogen frequency spectra, about the spectral lines, the colors. So I've been calculating and I've been trying to figure out how it works, and page after page after page, mistake after mistake. Look at these dots, what do they mean? I don't know. I've been searching in all kinds of places. I wanted to bring it home. It's not a map, same thing. I haven't been able to find a perpetual motion device or levitation. I wanted to bring it home so badly. I wanted to present to you now levitation. It will take a bit longer because I haven't been able to decipher what goes on in that atmosphere surrounding atoms. I used the Rutherford formulas. Rutherford's very smart man, but still I couldn't find it. But you know, I'm gonna bring up the speed so maybe you can find it. So I will present what I have achieved during those months, and perhaps you can find the solution of this. As I told you guys, I think there's much more organization. Why? Much more organized in the universe. Let's, for instance, look at this. This is the human eye. The human eye has cylinders and cones. Those cones are, as you can see, cascaded. They're not smooth, those lines. They cascade. There are certain corridors between that cylinder. Eyes are cylinders, and they capture the total amount of light, so that in dark we see black and white. That's those cylinders with those big corridors, of course. Those corridors are adjusted to capture yellow photons in the mid-range. And those cones here are for the color in our eyes, and they have certain corridors as well. And each corridor stands for a wavelength, a color. So this is how we see color, using those cones. So this points at a certain distance between those two, a certain distance which has to be according to the wavelength destroyed or created. This also we see in a double slit experiment. You have a laser, two slits, and you get this interference pattern, and that pattern only can emerge when you move photons from that laser to the other side along that tiny piece of metal to the other slit, and then create interference. And again, the size of that slit is very important. It has to be in relationship to that, to the frequency, to the wavelength of the laser light. So again, the size of the slit is very important in our eyes with the double slit theory. Polaroid glasses is a glass with all. This is a Polaroid glasses from close up. Polaroids filter the horizontal polarized photons from the vertical polarized photons. Again, there's a certain distance which is very important. With Polaroid glasses, as well. Also, we use glass fiber cables, and if you take a cross section of glass fiber cable, you get this. It's the outside, and you get different rings within. And if you see it from the side, it's like this. Photons bouncing through them are directed, are bent in such a fashion that they will always move that way. And that happens because this glass is a different kind of glass than that glass and that glass. So you use different kinds of glass to rearrange or redirect photons. Raindrop, surface of a water droplet in open air, it has also those, that atmosphere surrounding those atoms, creating these field lines, if you will, and white light comes in, fractures, and creates a rainbow. So certain distances are very important in creating and destroying photons, or even redirecting photons. So that brought me to the mystery of how do you call that? Oh yeah, the mystery of absorption, the absorption spectra. Take a cloud of hydrogen, there's a light source behind it, and the hydrogen absorbs specific frequencies. And that can only happen, and that's a bit of a guess, but not a very wild guess, but pretty logical, if all those hydrogen atoms are arranged in a pattern, in a mesh. Because if you have a mesh of hydrogen atoms, the atmosphere surrounding it, the rings surrounding it, create funnels, corridors, and can even change the direction of the photons passing through. So, I know from glass fiber cables, from the rainbow, from polaroid glasses, from the human eye, and from the double slit theory, that a certain distance is important in creating and destroying a certain frequency, a certain wavelength of light. And therefore, this is what happens in a cloud of hydrogen. They're not shooting all out, those hydrogen atoms. They're not flying all around, no, they're in a nice pattern. And of course, some places are more dense than others. And that's how they are able to absorb every single frequency. Now, those rings, of course, they are a product of quantization. Because if you have another quantizing, hydrogen quantizes those little gravitons, and they go at a certain speed, there's a certain speed difference, and those speed differences create all those wavelengths, and those speed differences also create those shells every time, so it makes perfect sense. So this brings me back to the Rutherford model, which I declined, of course, because this is an atom. In other words, this is an atom, period. So Rutherford was a bit off. But the thing is, if you take this atom and then see it as a core, and then see the shells around them, and those aren't electron shells, they're graviton shells. A graviton is physically the same object as an electron. But in this case, it are shields with different energies. They are created by a very crafty and vigorously working atom spinning, having all those spinning nucleons. They create that field, that concentric field. So, funny enough, after creating an atom, I discover that around the atom is a field, and a photonic layer which bounces back or absorbs or redirects photons or even creates it, and that field is concircular, has different shells. So this looks almost like the Rutherford atom, but in reality, in detail, it's not. But I would like to show it to you. So that's one thing I wanted to tell you. In short, the universe is much more organized than I thought. And so I learned along the way. So now I know how it's possible that a certain wavelength gets absorbed by gas, simply because all those atoms in that gas are, they can move if you have two atoms of gas. Of course, the distance between them can be any value, but in reality, it goes like this when they move towards each other, and like this when they move away from each other. Which means 95% of the time, they are indeed in an equilibrium. 95% of the time, they are in equilibrium, where those lines touch each other where they're happy. And when you increase the pressure, they just move towards each other in one blow. So that's what I've learned about gas clouds. And this is the only thing I came up with. It's the only explanation I can find for absorbing photons of a certain wavelength. More system in the universe. Now, another thing I wanted to discuss with you. Well, just in addition, you think, well, when I move my hand through space or an object through space, I will disturb this pattern. Well, nothing can be further from the truth, because this pattern gets fixed, gets rearranged with the speed of light. Those gravitons, which are it's made of, travel at the speed of light. So it mends itself at a very high pace. So don't worry, don't think my hand disturbs it, my hand doesn't move. It almost stands still compared to the speed of light. If I move an airplane with twice the speed of sound, it's still stationary compared to the speed of light. So every model we see, everything we use, always there is this pattern around it. It's every atom has those concentric rings around them. Not doesn't matter how fast they move. Of course, when you scratch the surface or when you bring them, when you bounce them onto each other, of course, then you will get a difference, but not because they move. That atmosphere is very consistent atmosphere surrounding those atoms. Let's have a bit, this is the way I see how photons work, how they have an object to quantize gravitons, bounce back from it, and they will find each other, creating an atom, a photon. And then that photon has a certain speed of itself, a certain velocity of itself. but of course, it gets propelled by the universe until it has the speed of light. But it, of course, has also a frequency. So here's an object creating the photon, then the photon goes through space, it cartoons through space, and then the receiving end. It's where the photon gets destroyed and the receiving end receives the energy of both individual gravitons the photon was made of. Photons, a few here, every photon has, every color has another size. I see here, this is the ultraviolet. They're completely entwined. It's almost Rankine. This is a bit bigger. It goes to the yellowish, and this is the infrared with a very little entwinement, this infrared photon. So, now something else which is very remarkable. You've seen the calculations, I've been calculating everything about photons, starting out, of course, with the hydrogen spectra, and I've, of all 36 lines, I calculated everything of the photons. All those photons have a different shape, have a different angular momentum, different inertia. And using that inertia, you can calculate inertia of a photon, because I know, if you have a photon, I know they are ball shaped springs. I know they are hollow. They are hollow ball shaped springs, right? It's like a hollow ball. And I know the size of them too. So I have the size. I have the... Interesting now, this is interesting. Graviton, it has a diameter of about 3 angstroms. The mass is 0.1383333 times 10 to the minus 27 kilograms. And the velocity, of course, is about light speed, depending. So I had these figures for, well, years, perhaps. Yeah, a few years now. So a few months ago, I used that information I had about photons to calculate the angular momentum of that photon, of that photon. And I started out with the low frequency of the hydrogen spectrum. The low frequency of the hydrogen spectrum, which is the infrared and the infrared end of the spectrum, which means having two of those gravitons a little bit entwined, creating a photon. And I calculated the angular momentum. And then I took the frequency of it, and so I could calculate the energy of a photon in flight. Because, again, this is how it goes. A photon gets created by two gravitons, then flies, and then gets dissected again. And then, over here, we measure the energy. And that energy measured by mainstream science is this. This is a simple fact. You can find this everywhere on the internet. You can calculate it yourself, if you will. This is mainstream science. This is common knowledge, this. A photon, the photon in the outer infrared spectrum, that photon has an energy of 1.59 times 10 to the minus 20 joules. Never use electron volts. Electron volts, that term is compromised. Some scientists use electron volts to indicate a mass, the mass of an object. Well, electron volts doesn't, it's voltage doesn't, has nothing to do with mass, has nothing to do with energy at all. So it's a useless term, electron volt. I don't use it, and I suggest you don't either. It's only confusing, electron volts. Electron volts is a very confusing term, don't use it. Only use joules for energy, and for mass, use kilograms. That's it. But this is a fact. Mainstream fact, known by every scientist, that certain photon having a wavelength of 12,400 being in the outer infrared spectrum of the hydrogen has this energy. And when I calculated it, this was my first time. I calculated it the first time I came this close. 1.59. See, the magnitude is the same. There is a bit of difference, I agree, but I started from scratch. I started designing the universe from scratch. That's what I came up with. And the funny part is, this is the energy in flight. And this is the energy after being dissected. In other words, that little friction here has to be overcome in order to dissect them. And when you take this and take that little friction of it, deduct the friction, you get this. Makes perfect sense. I have calculated the angular momentum for each photon in the hydrogen spectrum. Each photon. And I also know the energy after being dissected. So I could calculate the friction forces. And as it turned out, a photon absorbs energy when created, but also absorbs energy when dismantled. Could have been it just absorbs it and creates and then has a release mechanism shooting out and then the total energy remains the same. No, it takes energy, it turns energy into heat when created, but also when destroyed. This proves it. This is the photon after dissection. That's the energy we measure when it hits an object, when both individual gravitons, where the photon was made of, hit an object, this is energy you get, this is the energy it should have in flight. So this is just the friction, and that friction this again underscores how time can be influenced by gravity, how you have an object and above that object there is fast moving gravitons, and the deeper you go in our planet, the deeper you move, you will find slower gravitons. All the gravitons slower and slower, every time again, which causes gravitational effect and slower time when you get within our core. So it both complies with Einstein's spacetime, which is important, and it also complies with star drive. Of course, star drive gives you a more in-depth view of it. Einstein says time changes. No, time does not change. We all know that. It appears so to do so, but it doesn't change. There's a big difference. As time changes, protons will remain protons. When moving forward, say a hydrogen atom flies through space, has a certain frequency, spins around. If it goes very fast, then this electron orbit will pop in, you get this. Then this proton will turn into a neutron. And that's what happens. Which means time doesn't slow down, it only appears to do so. Because if we really slow down the movement of a nucleon, it will turn, all protons will turn into neutrons. So it's just an optical illusion that time slows down. But again, that was the second thing I wanted to show you. And maybe I don't hope I'm boring you, because I know I don't have the I give you wonderful videos, and my English is a bit, you know, horrible. So, but I hope you can understand what I mean with this, and I hope you can see the excitement I feel, the excitement when I just calculate for the first time the energy of a photon in flight, and then see what mainstream science says about it. It's practically the same, and only this little bit of friction causes that difference. So that's what I wanted to share with you. One thing, if you want to calculate the energy yourself, you can find the momentum, the angular momentum of those photons, you can find on the internet. Not on the website, but you can find on Wikipedia. You can find how a hollow ball, the angular momentum of the hollow ball, you can find. And it has the same angular momentum as a cylinder, as a hollow cylinder. And you can shove cylinders in and out of each other, creating those different photons all the time. And that's what I did. I cut a cylinder in four pieces and then started to fill them in and out of each other. And then so I could calculate the angular momentum of those photons and then added the frequency, and then I knew the energy of it. I also sort of did that, the forward motion, because all those atoms, they spin with the speed of light. Those things, those nucleons, they spin at the speed of light. So the forward motion of light speed, then it hits it, there is no energy difference. This moves to the speed of light, the photon moves to the speed of light, there's no difference between it. The only difference there is the spin of it. So there's the forward motion and, of course, the spinning around of it. The forward motion we deduct, spinning around we calculate. And that brings us to these numbers. I will upload it to my website, all those numbers, but that will take some time. But you can calculate them yourself, if you wish. If you want to do that, calculate yourself the energy of a photon in flight. And one small advice, small hint. This is how a photon moves through space. And you see A, and you see B mirrored. Yes, that's what happens. Those two sinuses combined, they create this. And this is the frequency mainstream science measures. Mainstream science measures four completed cycles, but it are only two. It only has been around two times completely, not four times, but it appears to do so because it's a symmetric object spinning around. So take the frequency, the mainstream frequency of all those spectral lines, and then divide that by two to get the real frequency, the real cycle. So that's it, and well, I say good luck, because I've been struggling with it. I will move on with this, but maybe you're faster, maybe you're smarter, maybe you see things I don't see, and maybe it will help you discover the universe, or even win a Nobel Prize right ahead of me. I don't care. I'm not here for Nobel Prizes or for money or what. I want to make this world a better place, right? So maybe you can find it. Maybe you can discover how a photon exactly gets created, why it exactly gets dissected, how this thing works, and then see the byproducts of it. Or maybe then you discover the gamma radiation coming away from it, or then you see, hey, now we know what magnetism is. Maybe, because that atmosphere surrounding those atoms gives us a very big insight on what goes on. And if you can find, if you can define that atmosphere in all detail, then you can maybe use it in your advantage to create levitation. So, we'll see. That's it for now. Thanks, and have a nice day.